We will be showcasing four projects that have recently received funding from NJDEP for mitigation of harmful algal blooms as part of their grant program. The first one will be focusing on Rosedale Lake in Mercer County. And this will be presented by Ed Confair and Claire Moriarty with ENLP. So with that, I'm going to make Claire unmute you and make you the presenter. And I'll do introductions while you get loaded up there, Claire, okay?
Mm-hmm.
All right, great. So Claire is a project engineer with ENLP Associates. She graduated from Clemson University with a minor in sustainability and a degree in biosystems engineering. She's worked on a variety of private and public land development projects throughout New Jersey, focusing on creative designs that merge resilient practices with site functionality. And Ed Confair is a senior program manager for resiliency at ENLP Associates. He has 15 years of experience specializing in urban, civic, residential, and commercial projects from concept through construction. He's a licensed PE and landscape architect, and he holds a bachelor's degree in civil engineering and architecture from Lehigh and a master's in landscape architecture from the University of Pennsylvania, where he's also a guest lecturer in stormwater management. And so with that, I will hand it off to you guys.
Great. Thanks,
Brian.
Pleasure to be here today. We're excited to be kicking off this seminar on HABs. We will be talking about a project that we are doing with the Watershed Institute and Mercer County Park Commission at Rosedale Lake. So Brian just introduced us very well, thank you. But again, my name's Ed. Claire, we're both available for follow-up after this. Questions at the end. So since we're going first here, we're going to give a little bit of an overview on HABs just to introduce the topic, and then we'll move into our project at Rosedale Lake, where we'll look at the site background there and its history with HABs, then our current project scope and mitigation measures, and then the water quality monitoring program that we have set up to take place over the next 18 months. So harmful algal blooms, again, this is a brief overview. I hope everyone's in the right seminar here today, that you're here to hear about algae and all its various colors and harmful effects on our recreational water bodies. If you are not, then by all means, stick around though and become educated. So what are these? So they're photosynthetic organisms that grow in our water bodies. They can be red, blue, green, brown, variety of colors, variety of impacts, and the types of cyanotoxins and bacteria that make them up and that, you know, you would deal with in potential mitigation measures. Are they dangerous? Yes, they can really harm an ecosystem, both flora and fauna, and they are dangerous to humans as well. They can be dangerous to pets, small animals. You know, don't let your dogs drink a HAB-impacted lake, please. Do they last a long time? Yes, if gone unchecked. It's impossible to predict how long they could last on their own. There's a number of physical and biological conditions that contribute to them and their lifespan, and you're going to hear about a variety of those here today. And the good news is, though, that they can be mitigated. There are prevention measures and mitigation measures if one has already taken shape in your local water body. What causes them? I think you're going to hear the gamut today and the measures that a variety of professionals are taking in four different water bodies. But in general, phosphorus, nutrient, you know, nutrient-rich runoff from agricultural lands, lawn, stormwater, et cetera, can all impact HABs. Circulation, stagnant water can contribute. High temperatures, extreme weathers with climate change has an undeniable effect on HABs. And then other factors, organisms that may be present or site-specific. And the effects can potentially be devastating. Microorganisms can become affected. It makes its way up through the food chain of everything else that's residing in and around the water body. There's harmful effects if ingested for humans, potential liver damage, neurological effects, skin irritation and rashes. Environmentally, it can affect the whole food chain around a water body. And think economically. I know Rosedale Lake has been impacted by this. I know Lake Opatcong is. A number of important recreational water bodies last summer were shut down due to HABs, and that can have a devastating impact on local companies that rely on the swimming, fishing, and boating on recreational use. So that's a brief overview. You're going to hear way more detail as all the presentations progress today. So switching over to specifically Rosedale Lake and just looking at a history of the site. It's kind of at the center here, you see highlighted of an 800-acre complex that is Mercer Meadows. The Park Commission worked for a long time to assemble all of these different parcels. There's over 15 miles of trails throughout the system. If we look at the zoning in the area, you'll see that it's largely a rural residential area in the surrounding townships. But you can start to see some more of those dark hatches at the lower end of the site. The lower end of the site, which is where the tributaries that feed the lake are a little more densely developed with a little bit of commercial and more dense residential. Even though to the north it's a little more spread out, the areas that's actually feeding the lake and we're getting that nutrient-rich runoff are from more dense areas. And if we look at our local DEP mapping to the north, the big takeaway here is the site has a dam at the north end and it discharges into the Stony Brook, which is a category one water. So that's a important water body. It's heavily regulated and we don't want any HABs present in the lake to start migrating and impact a second water body to the north of the site. And if we look at the land use classification for landscape, you can see it's the darkest green, which is rank 5. And so that means there's a lot of federally listed threatened and endangered species, both plant life and animal on the site. So again, it's a sensitive ecosystem around the lake and we don't want HABs to impact it in an adverse way. Historically, the site itself has not been heavily developed. It was an AT&T pole farm for a long time. There is one pole left on the site incorporated into an interpretive feature. And for the most part, it's passive recreation trails, open meadows that have been restored, an equestrian center, and then the lake itself. And it basically breaks down into 5 areas. There's the historic elements on the site, the hunt house, some of the old barn structures which have been kept and interpreted. There's a number of bird blinds, observation towers. Stewardship is one of the main cruxes of the overall park complex, and the County Park Commission has gone to great lengths to restore meadows, habitat walks, insect walks, etc. And Rosedale Lake is kind of the center of all of that. I'm going to pass it over to Claire.
All right, so moving on to our project scope. So some background on the issue, as Ed mentioned earlier, the past 2 summers, Rosedale Lake has been plagued with HABs as seen in the articles on screen. This really encouraged Mercer County Park Commission to apply to the NJDEP grant funding to help mitigate and prevent any future HABs on site. And as you'll hear, it's a common issue faced by many of the New Jersey water bodies in the area. So our project goal basically is to manage water quality conditions by decreasing nutrient concentrations and increasing lake aeration. We propose to accomplish this through BMPs such as an aerator device, barley bales, and constructed floating wetlands. ENLP's specific project scope is to put together design plans, submit a permit application to DEP, assist Mercer County in the bid process, and provide construction administration, and then finally monitoring the water quality parameters once construction is complete. So as mentioned previously, Mercer County applied and received the NJDEP grant awarded amount of $185,000. So with the match that the county provided, the project total is about $246,000. So the first step in the project was to study the site and the surrounding areas. This image shows Rosedale Lake's tributaries and complete drainage area. In the southwestern portion, there's a densely populated residential area. And in the southeastern portion, it's more agricultural based. So both types of land can produce nutrient-rich runoff that eventually flows into Rosedale Lake. So after analyzing the overall drainage area, the project team thought it'd be best to treat water as it flowed into the lake through the tributary inlets to the south and the southwest. Therefore, if the water from the surrounding areas is nutrient rich, then hopefully our BMPs can prevent the inflow from affecting the rest of the lake. So the highlighted areas are here. Once our large scale analysis was complete, the project team met for a site walk to understand the current conditions at Rosedale Lake. The team wanted to highlight the problem areas and choose potential water quality monitoring locations. And so the image on the screen is kind of a legend of the pictures I'm about to show you. And so we have pictures of the both tributary inlets, the outlet dam, and the western shore. So this is the southwestern inlet. So you can see the inlet pipe underneath the entry driveway. This flows kind of along a long narrow stream before it opens up into the larger water body. So the shores of that stream are pretty densely vegetated, and as seen in the photo on the right, when we were out there, there was already filamentous vegetation on the water surface. So the next picture is the southern tributary. And this inlet is a little more wider spread, and it kind of looks like an inundated wetland. The water is pretty shallow in the area, which means that it can have higher water temperatures. And that mixed with the nutrient levels coming in from the tributary, it can create a problem area in the future. So these images are taken of the western shore. The first picture is along the northern shoreline, and it's looking south. So you can see the kayak ramp and the fishing dock in the distance. And the fishing dock has had a history of blooms that are surrounding it. This picture on the right is the western shore, so it's looking east. And this is kind of where the smaller kayak ramp is that's used for recreational activities. These two photos are based on the northern outlet. So the first picture is of the outlet structure of Rosedale Lake. And the second is the outlet pipe and the pond. So this pond is actually the one that will flow directly into the Stony Brook. These are additional photos of the dam. So these are along the northern shore looking south to Rosedale Park. And then as you can see, the second photo is the northeastern area of the lake looking south, and there's some dense wetland vegetation along the shoreline. And this has been an area of concern in the past. So ENLP has worked on many Mercer County park projects in the past. So we have much of the park system surveyed that we can utilize as our base plans. So this survey particularly shows the topography of the site, the roads, the tree lines, and any hardscape features. So we have started to put design plans together. Right now we're proposing water quality monitoring locations, the location of the aerator device in the northern portion of the lake, and then the constructed floating wetlands and barley bales at the tributary inlets. So this is a zoom in of the northern portion. The aerator location was proposed here because the fishing dock and the northeastern pocket of the lake have had a history of high algal counts. We wanted to provide circulation in the deepest area of the lake before the water is routed out to the Stony Brook. This is an image of the southwestern inlet area. And so you can see we're proposing constructed floating wetlands and the barley bales here. And then the same for the southern inlet. So the project will need to be permitted because of the regulated areas. So we are submitting for similar general permits for both NJDEP's flood hazard area and freshwater wetlands. We already completed our pre-application meeting with DEP, and they're really excited about the project and don't really see any issues with what we're proposing. So our next steps after that would be bid administration. So here's a quick snapshot of our project schedule. So once we get NJDEP approval, then we can move into the bidding process. And then after that, we can move into our construction phase. So the final phase of the project would be monitoring, and that would happen after the construction of the BMPs is complete. And this would include water quality monitoring and providing quarterly and final reports to DEP. So as mentioned earlier, the locations A through E shown on the screen were chosen by the project team due to current and historical problem areas. And the inlets and outlet were chosen strategically for nutrient control and monitoring. So here's a quick overview that we'll go over in depth further in the presentation, but our monitoring parameters include in situ and chemical. So the main chemical parameters are nitrogen, phosphorus, and chlorophyll A. Okay, so moving into our mitigation measures to help all of that. So our first proposed BMP is an aerator device. So generally, lakes need to diffuse oxygen in the form of air to replace what is consumed by the aquatic animals. This allows the water to release toxic gases produced by plants in decomposition in the water. As seen in the top picture, stagnant water slows down the gas exchange. Additionally, dust, pollen, and debris can collect at the surface, which impedes oxygen diffusion even further. Dissolved oxygen is a temperature-dependent parameter, so warmer water at the surface holds less oxygen than the cooler, denser water at the bottom. So this differential can cause a physical barrier between the surface and deeper water called a thermocline, which is shown in the picture. This cuts off the surface oxygen from the deeper water, and therefore the lower oxygen levels at the bottom create a more anaerobic process for decomposition. And the slower the organic matter decomposes, the more toxic compounds it can produce, such as methane and sulfur dioxide. So signs of imbalance in your lake or water body would be algae, excess submerged vegetation, dead fish, smaller, fewer, or no live fish, and foul-smelling water. And the causes for this would be the dissolved oxygen levels that I was just talking about, or excessive nutrients in the water, or the stratification that cuts off the oxygen. So the second photo shows a lake that is happily aerated. Aeration doesn't inject oxygen into the lake, but it does greatly increase the surface area of the air contact with the water. So the greater the surface area, the faster oxygen in the air can diffuse into DO and other toxic gases can diffuse out. A shoreline compressor pumps air through tubing to the diffusers at the bottom of the lake. The diffusers release the tiny bubbles that are seen in the photo, and the surface area of the bubbles effectively doubles or even triples unassisted rate of gas exchange to maximize the highest possible level of oxygen. So these bubbles also provide friction in the water. So as they move upwards, they pull a rising column of cooler, denser air to the surface, which creates that boil that's up at the top. The anaerobic water that rushes upward sheds toxic gas and picks up oxygen as it flows across the surface. And the surface cools, and the cooler water can then carry the dissolved oxygen back to the bottom of the lake. The flow up and out of the edges actually creates a countercurrent inwards along the bottom that you can see. This feeds more water into the rising pillar of water and bubbles. So overall, aeration, it helps decrease algae and weeds due to the cooling temperatures, and the ample oxygen speeds up the consumption of waste, therefore removing excess nutrients from the water column. So a few tips on sizing your aeration system. The deeper the water, the longer the path to the surface is, and therefore the more water that each bubble can pull up to the surface. Water rising from a deeper set diffuser has larger momentum, and it can cause outward flow in all the directions once it reaches the surface. So deeper lake aerators can manage more water volume. So in contrast, your shallower lakes might need more diffusers because they don't have as large diameters. And then if your water body is not circular, that your diameter might be, you know, changing. So you could use many aerators in different layouts. So here's a typical set that would come from your aeration device. So the first one, your main thing is your air compressor that is going to be sitting on shore. So that provides constant flow of air, and it's sized to deliver the correct volume of air to the correct depth. And that's usually housed in this cabinet that's seen. So that's, you know, muffles the sound of the air, the compressor, while also ventilating it to keep the compressor from overheating. Tubing is connected into that system, and this specific type has weighted tubing that sinks to the bottom of the lake, so it's out of sight from people and won't mess with any of the boats or the water surface. And then those actually connect into the structures at the bottom of the lake, which are the diffusers, and those emit the bubbles. So the second proposed BMP are barley bales. So naturally occurring organisms in the lake will actually decompose organic polymers in the barley. So when that happens, it releases organic substances into the water, and with exposure to sunlight and oxygen, the compounds are converted into low levels of hydrogen peroxide, and this modifies the lake's chemistry, which improves the water quality. So these can be implemented by staking them in shallow waters along the shorelines. And for the best results, you should apply them early in the season because they're more of a preventative measure than a reactive measure. They're safe for all the aquatic life in your water body, and you should replace them every 3 to 6 months based on the decomposition. For our specific project scope, we're proposing a rate of 5 bales per surface acre of the lake at Rosedale. And the recommended quantity is about 2 to 3 bales per surface acre. However, if you've had a history of any algal blooms, they recommend the first treatment to be 2 or 3 times that. So in total, we're proposing 150 bales, which will be split evenly between the southern and southwestern tributary inlets. So finally, our third BMP are the constructed floating wetlands. So they're kind of an up-and-coming efficient green infrastructure tool for filtering pollutants from stormwater, wastewater, and freshwater bodies. They're a buoyant wetland system with emergent vegetation and submerged roots. The mat is constructed from synthetic materials, which actually keeps it afloat. And the plants are water tolerant, and the root systems grow into the water, creating a hydroponic system. The roots creates a high amount of oxygen surface area, which also uptakes the nutrients in the water column. It's estimated that 1 250 square foot CFW has the root and microbial mat surface area equivalent to nearly 175 times that of a natural wetland. And that would have the potential to mitigate approximately 11,000 pounds of algal biomass per year. So these pictures are CFWs in practice. And so our project is proposing to install 1,000 square feet of constructed floating wetlands in Rosedale Lake to remove nutrients directly from the lake's water column to combat future HABs. The floating wetlands will be constructed by the Wetlands Institute, the Watershed Institute, and will be filled with wetland plants according to Rosedale Lake's summer sunlight conditions. I'll hand it back over to Ed.
Great, thanks, Claire. So to wrap us up here, looking at water quality monitoring, once the BMPs are installed, we'll be doing 12 months of monitoring at the 5 locations around the lake. To start off this summer, we did do baseline monitoring, and we did log those results on DEP's website. They've got a GIS-enabled site, so we're taking our latitude and longitude coordinates everywhere and logging so we can kind of see the history update on each site. And this is an open platform. You can check out the website link shown on the slide to look at a variety of sites around the state that are being monitored and logged. This specifically is the history at Rosedale. So you can see the site has hit in the past a number of different conditions, from not present up to a warning level. Go to the next slide. This year, before our team started, what kind of precipitated us was that the site did get an advisory warning And if you look at the subsequent map, it was up by that dock where they historically had it. So early on in the season, they identified visually that they thought they had an HAB developing. They tested it, and it did come back at a high level. Subsequently, the site did apply an algicide, and then we went out for further baseline monitoring, and we got a couple of watch hits, but mostly not present. And what we saw was all three of the watch hits were from the north end of the lake. So, you know, looking at the drainage area, looking at where water was flowing, there was kind of a consistent inflow of water from the south and west, pushing water to the north, but then it kind of sits and gets stagnant there before spilling out through the control device built into the dam. This wasn't too surprising to our team that these were the most elevated levels of algal counts. So we'll continue to monitor, and we hope that the combination of preventative measures in the south and southwest, and then the aerator to help with what we believe is a stagnant water condition in the north, will prevent these from happening in the future, and we'll see lower counts on subsequent monitoring. So a little more detail about what we are looking at. Temperature, this is important as it's linked to tracking warmer surfaces at the water. Should also say that we're sampling at the water surface level and 1 meter below to see the differences in different temperature ranges. pH governs ecological and biochemical processes. Conductivity we're looking at to measure nitrate and phosphate since they carry a negative charge. Turbidity we are monitoring because algal growth is related to limited transparency through the presence of dense organic matter. And dissolved oxygen, as it can be a byproduct of photosynthesis or wave wind action that allows surface water to be exposed to the atmosphere. So chemical parameters, nitrogen and phosphorus, as mentioned previously, these influence the growth of biomass and algae in lakes. And chlorophyll A is a pigment that all algae and plants possess and use in the process of photosynthesis. So algae population in the lake water can be measured by the concentration of chlorophyll A. This is a printout of the baseline sampling. It's probably a little tough to read, but the ones that are reading higher are those sample logs 4 and 5 at the north end of the lake. And then all of the lower southern sample locations that were coming back not present are very low on the charts. So we're anxious to get these installed in the spring and begin our monthly sampling late next spring, early summer, so that we can start to see the change over time and seasonally as we continue to monitor each location. And again, our contact info for both Claire and myself is in the lower right there. If you want to email any follow-up questions that don't come to you now. We're happy to take any questions or Brian, if we've got to move on to the next one. I think we're right up against the clock. We can do that as well.
If anyone has any good questions, feel free to post them. We have a minute or two here before we move on. I have one question, Ed and Claire. First of all, thank you very much for the presentation. It was great. One question I had was, you mentioned the floating wetlands. I believe that Rosedale Lake is a stocked water, and wondering what, you know, ancillary benefits there are for the aquatic life in Rosedale Lake for what you're proposing.
Sure. Yeah, we are. We expect there to be a good amount, especially for waterfowl. Specifically, we're sticking to a tighter palette that the Watershed Institute has a high degree of confidence and past ones they've done. So it's a combination of sedges, rushes, blue flag iris, swamp milkweed, water plantain, and pickleweed. So it's a small group of diversity, but we know that they're gonna do the job and survive in the conditions of the lake. And we were also, in terms of what we want to keep out of them, we will have to make sure that, you know, they don't attract any geese or anything that can kind of lay waste to constructed wetlands pretty quickly.
This is Fred Lubno. Just a quick comment on that. So we've been installing floating wetland islands for a good decade, and one thing that we've been seeing is the islands do attract a lot of macroinvertebrates and zooplankton, which in turn attract fish. So fishermen love the floating wetland islands. The other thing to keep in mind, though, is that the first year may want to install some goose netting over the vegetation.
Yes.
If you don't, it's like a buffet for geese.
Right.
The first five islands we installed in 2009, we didn't inspect them in the spring. We installed them in the late summer, went out in the spring, and then four of the five islands were fine, but the one island, the goose netting fell, and it was like a buffet. Not only did the geese eat all the vegetation, but they actually laid eggs on the island. So we actually had to get a wildlife specialist to remove the eggs and replant. So definitely goose netting will go a long way.
Yeah, the Watershed Institute has done these in the past and installed a bunch. So they'll be in charge of monitoring. So they have a lot of experience with it. So we have faith in them.
Excellent.
Great. All right, I think we will move on here with the time. Thanks, everybody. Thank you, Ed and Claire, again.
Yeah, thank you.
And with that, Aaron, I'm going to make you the presenter. Let's see here.
I'm also going to unmute myself. Hopefully I did that.
Yeah, you're good.
Okay, great.
Okay, so Aaron Devel is going to be presenting on Echo Lake with the Newark Water Department. Aaron has over 7 years of experience in environmental consulting with expertise in stormwater, green infrastructure design, environmental permitting. She's worked on a wide variety of projects, including water quality studies, water resource litigation issues, treatment plant design, stormwater design. She has a bachelor's degree of civil engineering from TCNJ and a master's degree in civil engineering from Villanova. So with that, I will pass it over to you. Thank you.
All right, great. Thanks everyone for coming today, and I appreciate the attendance level. I've also been involved in AWRA about as long as my career, so it's been exciting. So today I want to talk to you guys about a project that Kleinfelder is currently performing with the city of Newark up in their watersheds in the Pequannock Treatment Plant. And based on the uniqueness of that watershed, we are using an interesting ultrasonic technology to mitigate haves. So what I'm going to talk to you guys about today is just a little bit of an overview on the Pequannock Water Treatment Plant that serves the majority of Newark. I'm going to dive into an overview of the watershed itself, and just talk about the historic haves and give a super brief overview on haves, since we had a great overview on that already. I'm gonna talk a little bit about the haves grant that we got from NJDEP, and then go through the project need and our strategy, and then talk about some of the preliminary things that we've been able to do this season, and then looking to the future, what we're gonna do the next 2 years. So this is just an overview of the Pequannock Water Treatment Plant. You can see it's way up there in North Jersey. It's owned by the City of Newark Water and Sewer Utilities, and it's located in West Milford, which is in Passaic County. And it provides more than half of Newark's drinking water supply, so about 500,000 residents. And there are five pretty large reservoirs that serve the water treatment plant's intake. So here's a zoom in and a better overview of the watershed. Can you guys see my mouse? I think you can. I'll be pointing to stuff.
Yes, we can.
Okay, great. So the watershed itself is pretty large. It's about 39,000 acres. The Pequannock River, which is highlighted in this greenish color, runs basically through the middle of the watershed. And the Pequannock River, its headwaters start way up to the north here, and it feeds the Pompton River as it flows down to the southeast and down out the page to the east. In this watershed, there's 132 miles of streams, which more than half of them are the C1 classification. and a little over a quarter of them are the FW1 highest classification. Throughout the watershed, it's actually pretty hilly up north. I don't know who is familiar with the area, but it's super pretty up there. 8% of the watershed is categorized as steep slopes, so over 25% slope. And I did not include a picture of the steep slopes, but a bunch of these reservoirs actually do have steep slopes bounding them. So we thought that's pretty interesting. And there are five, like I said before, there's five watersheds feeding the Pequannock treatment plant. So we have the Oak Ridge Reservoir and the Charlotteburg Reservoir, which are in line with the Pequannock River. And then we have, as offshoots from the Pequannock, we have the Canisteer Reservoir, which is up here to the north, the Clinton Reservoir, and then we also have Echo Lake down here. So the Pequannock treatment plant is that green star, and its intake draws water from Charlotteburg. And then operationally, they can pull water from the other reservoirs to supply the Charlotteburg Reservoir. So here's another map of the watershed, just looking at from a land use, land cover perspective using DEP's GIS coverages. As you can see, this area is very natural, very pristine. 71% of the watershed is forested, and we barely have any agricultural uses up here. It's, 1% or I think a little bit less than 1%. There's a lot of wetland coverage, a lot of water coverage, and then it is 7% urban. And of that urban land use, it's generally comprised of low density residential and rural. So just to bring home the point that this is a very pristine, not very urbanized watershed. And I also thought this slide was important to include. It's entirely within the Highlands Preservation Area. And the Highlands Council, in their regional master plan, has ranked the watershed as high in forest integrity, watershed value, and riparian integrity. So again, this is a very high resource value area. And this is just taking a super quick operational look of how the Pequannock water treatment plant functions. So as I mentioned previously, the treatment plant has its intake drawing directly from the Charlotteburg Reservoir. And each reservoir is equipped with a spillway and gatehouse, so they can choose to draw water from different reservoirs as needed. And one thing to note about Echo Lake is that it has an overflow spillway that passively will flow downstream into the Macoupin River and bypass the Pequannock treatment plant downstream into the Pequannock River. And they also can operationally draw from Echo Lake, but they typically do not because Echo Lake does have lower water quality than the other reservoirs to draw from. So they historically do not draw water from Echo Lake. All right, this is my one slide on HAVs, since we got a great overview from the first presentation. So again, real quick, you can have, if you have a nutrient-rich reservoir, you can have a rapid growth of algae. It can look like foam, scum, mats. The harmful kind of algae is typically not true algae. Oftentimes it's cyanobacteria that behaves like algae, which can cause harm to animals, people, and the local ecology. And a HABS bloom can generally occur in any water environment in New Jersey. It can recur in freshwater, marine water, or any brackish waters. And I just included two nice pictures from DEP's website of how some HABS can look. Some can look like paint spills. Some look like streamers going through the water there. Okay, and so specifically in the Pequannock watershed, they've had a history of algae blooms, and specifically in Echo Lake. So the city of Newark does perform a weekly rotating sampling of the overall algae count in Echo Lake. And I just put a few examples here of some of the counts they've been seeing over the past couple of years. So in July, they will have high algae counts, of which they previously would treat with copper sulfate, and then they would have to close Echo Lake to the public. I'll get a little bit more into the public use of Echo Lake in a few slides. And then Canisteer in 2019, NJDEP was identified a harmful algal bloom at Canisteer, and they came out and sampled it. And they saw cyanobacteria levels approaching 9 million cells with microcystins around 400 micrograms per liter, which I believe is the warning category on DEP's HABS table that I think most of us are familiar with. So Canisteer warning signs were posted. Canisteer is typically only used for boating and fishing, so they posted the warning signs at the boat launches. And this to the right here is a picture of the bloom in Canisteer in 2019. So given some of the HABS issues that the city of Newark has been experiencing, you know, they really wanted to take advantage of this grant opportunity offered by DEP. And so given the scale of the watershed and given, you know, the nature of the project, we requested a total grant of $475,000. And with the match, that meant the total project budget was $665,000. And included in this grant, we are holding to monitoring for 3 years, data validation and verification, and a project report at the conclusion, you know, overviewing the effectiveness of the HABS control, any future recommendations, and alignment with other watershed management strategies that Newark is undertaking. So with that, I wanted to dive in to the technology that we chose for the HABS control and why we need the HABS control. So why we need the HABS control is multifaceted. There's a huge community benefit for the use of Echo Lake specifically, plus the other three reservoirs are used recreationally. The only reservoir not used recreationally is Charlotteburg Reservoir, which is the intake to the treatment plant. And so the city of Newark runs an educational youth camp, which brings kids out of Newark up to Echo Lake specifically. Sometimes they tour the other reservoirs, and it's a great natural educational outreach for those kids. Also, there's a socioeconomic value to the local businesses that benefit from visitors and people using the reservoirs for recreational purposes. This project is also a step in the right direction for environmental justice because the city of Newark historically has been subjected to disproportionate levels of pollution. And so addressing HABS is just, you know, one step in the right direction and in alignment with Governor Murphy's legislation for environmental justice. And I mentioned this before, so Echo Lake is historically known for subpar water quality. So addressing these HABS is expected to improve water quality and help it achieve its designated uses. And this is also in alignment with watershed-wide planning efforts that the city of Newark is currently undertaking. They are currently developing watershed program plans to help run their watershed more effectively. Okay, so getting to the HABS control strategy. So as I mentioned before, the Pequannock watershed is minimally developed. It's pristine. It's an exceptional resource value. And when we look at each reservoir, there's a very large area to cover. We've got steep slopes. And so much of the nutrient loading to those reservoirs is from natural sources, we believe. So that's why we turned to the solution of ultrasonic technology, which can not only mitigate, but control the algal blooms and also prevent them in the future. Okay, so here's a little graphic of the ultrasonic technology. So without treatment, basically if you have a nutrient-rich water with sunlight, you know, you're going to have your algal bloom. But with treatment, if you deploy a buoy that has an ultrasonic pulse, essentially the ultrasonic pulse disrupts the, it fixes the algae in the water column and disrupts the vesicles in the cyanobacteria, so they are unable to photosynthesize. So they essentially die of starvation, sink to the bottom, and then naturally decompose over time. Okay, so these ultrasonic waves can eliminate up to 90% of the bloom. When you install them, they prevent new blooms when in use. You can maximize the effectiveness of them by fine-tuning the frequency of the ultrasonic wave to hone in on what's most effective for your watershed. And the waves do not cause what's called cell lysis, so they do not break the cell membrane of the algae, so no toxins are immediately released, and the algae do decompose slowly over time. The algae also do not sense an attack, so to speak, so there's no immediate toxin release. And this will, you know, by combating HABs this way, you can lower the TSS and the pH levels without impacting the ecosystem. And this technology is also safe for humans and pets and the local ecology, aside of HABs. But so this is the unit that we chose. There's a couple manufacturers of these ultrasonic units, so we did go through a bid process, but we settled on this unit, which is pretty large. I have some pictures of our team building them in a couple of slides. So it's equipped with in-situ water quality sensors, so it real-time collects data on chlorophyll A, which is a good indicator for, you know, your overall algal biomass. Phycocyanin, which is a good indicator for your blue-green algae. It also records dissolved oxygen, turbidity, temperature, pH, and ORP, which is the oxidation reduction potential in the water. That reminds me of grad school chemistry class. It also is equipped with solar panels as the power supply for the units. And what's awesome about this technology is it has a smart comm, so we can take a look at the real-time data and view it on our computer. So I hopefully have enough time at the end to really quickly show you guys the data. So just really quick about the implementation strategy. So due to Echo Lake's historic water quality issues, and also its high recreational usage compared to the other reservoirs, it was prioritized. So we deployed 6 units in Echo Lake, which provides full ultrasonic wave coverage, which were installed in September. We installed 1 unit at Canisteer in September as well, close to the outfall. And we anticipate to install 1 unit at Charlotteburg. There was an issue with the anchor length depth, so our installation failed this season, unfortunately, but we're going to get it out there for next season. And so these units are deployed essentially during the non-winter months, so we're gonna pull the units pretty soon here as the temperatures get colder, and we anticipate to monitor the next 2 years, because this year already happened. All right, so here's just some pictures to give you a sense of scale of these things. I mean, they're pretty sizable. We've got some Kleinfelder folks out there building it. Unfortunately, I was not able to go out there and help build it, but it seems like a fun time. 12-hour days. I think they spent 2 days out there. Such as them constructing the solar panels. And I believe this is Echo Lake, and this is them figuring out how to deploy these units. So they are floating, but they're also anchored in place so that they don't drift around the water. Here's another good shot. You can see the buoys here. Okay, so I wanted to talk a little bit more about data. So now we've got these in situ ultrasonic units deployed out there, but we also need to do some more work on our end to verify and validate the in situ units, and also make correlations to any data trends that we see. So we take grab samples on a weekly basis, and we took, I can't remember exactly how many we took this year, to verify that the units are working accurately. So taking grab samples, we tested them for the phytoplankton identification on a genus level. We also tested for chlorophyll A, pheophyton A, which I believe you can develop a good sense of what type of phytoplankton you have based on the relationship between pheophyton A and chlorophyll A. We also tested for microcystins. So that's the toxic component of your harmful algal bloom. Also, when the grab samples were taken, we just did in situ pH and temperature. And unfortunately, I don't have a lot of data analysis for you today. But that's underway for this season. So we're taking a look at the phycocyanin recorded by our in situ ultrasonic units and the microcystin that we've tested in the lab to see the correlations there, because that will be specific to our water body. We're also taking a look at the City of Newark's gathered algae information data, because they do their weekly cell count sampling. And we're working to establish baseline trends to determine, you know, the risk of human exposure in these watersheds. So moving forward, it would be great for us to be able to look at data and have an understanding of, you know, what is the risk of the harmful algal bloom on that day. All right, and with that, if I have a few minutes here, which I think I do.
Go ahead.
Okay, I'm going to attempt to show you guys some of the real-time data here. All right, so this is the data viewer of our ultrasonic units. So over here we have the 6 units in Echo Lake, and then up here we have that 1 unit in Canisteer. And I'm going to focus on Echo Lake right now. So let me just select one of these units here. And I have some pre-made graphics or graphs in here that we set up to basically show us a nice little dashboard. So the units read a sample every 30 minutes and then graph them. So let me actually go to my all view. So this shows all the data we've collected since installation, which was around September 2nd. And so right now we're taking a look at chlorophyll A in micrograms per liter, the phycocyanin in micrograms per liter, and turbidity. And the units have a typo in it, that it's like the typical turbidity units. And I can move my mouse and scroll around and see any given 30 minutes, the level of the chlorophyll A, the phycocyanin, and the turbidity. And when they were deployed, they were set at a certain baseline ultrasonic frequency. And as we noticed uptrending in our phycocyanin, we can real-time modify the frequency of the ultrasonic waves. And so these notes down here have recorded any time that we've changed the ultrasonic frequency based on the phycocyanin trends. And so as you can, as you can see, you know, in September, where this is actually pretty low concentration of chlorophyll A and phycocyanin, but we were able to live track all of it over the course of September, and the units are still deployed out there now. So that was pretty cool. So we're basically going to take this information, compare it to our grab sample data, and establish exactly what, you know, what kind of algae is out there, and how do we mitigate it so we don't have to close the reservoirs. And with that,
Got a couple questions, Erin.
Okay.
The first question was from Tom Amadon. Does this technology discriminate among algae types in any way?
It does not. It is a total algae inhibitor, if you will. Okay. Yep.
And the second was, can the units be adjusted higher or lower depending on algal conditions? If not, what trophic impacts might be expected from continuous depression of primary production on such a large scale?
Ooh, that's a doozy, Tom.
Unmuted.
I'm here for you, Erin.
Thank you. What do you mean by higher or lower? Do you mean the level of coverage in the water body?
It sounds like the thing that you adjust is the frequency.
Correct. And so each unit has a radius of coverage, essentially. I forget exactly the footage out from the centroid of the unit. So it's only effective in areas that the ultrasonic wave can reach, if that makes sense. So you could either provide full coverage to a lake or partial coverage, if you get what I'm saying.
I guess the question was, can you dial it up or dial down the intensity of it? Is that what you were asking, Tom?
Yeah, I mean, especially in Echo Lake, where you've really deployed it almost lake-wide, right?
Yes,
you know, we've deployed it lake-wide. You could potentially be depressing primary production generally if this were applied all the time. And I don't know if that's important or, you know, if anybody's thought about that.
No, that is a good point. So it does totally suppress the algae when it is in use. I think I did hear Felipe trying to chime in, though.
Yes, thank you, Erin. So when we were selecting these units, we did a lot of literature review and project experience in other parts of the world. And this ultrawave signals that they're being sent, they're targeting the flotation devices of particular harmful algae. It's not attacking everything, it's just triggered to attack the specific ones that produce the harmful algal blooms. The frequency is what changes, but we can also, by changing the arms in the units, it could be set up at different depths. That's the second approach, at different levels. Each unit has four transmitters pointing in all directions, and they have a reach of 500 feet of diameter around the units. So we were trying to cover all the area of the lake. There is no purpose of putting this unit in a lake where you're not covering the whole area, because then you have the shallow areas where you tend to have the highest level of conditions to generate an algal bloom. So results are still to come, but yeah.
Thanks, Felipe. I think you had a question from Fred that you just answered, so good job. So with that, I think with the time, we'll move on to the next presentation, but thanks so much, Erin and Felipe.
Thanks, guys.
All right. So with that, I'm going to make Heather Desko the presenter. Heather, you there?
I am here.
Okay. All right, you should be the presenter now. Heather Desko is a senior watershed protection specialist for the New Jersey Water Supply Authority. She's going to be presenting on Spruce Run Reservoir and the work there. She joined the authority in 2009 after serving as an AmeriCorps New Jersey Watershed Ambassador. She manages the authority's water monitoring programs, aquatic invasive species and harmful algal bloom projects, and river-friendly business and school certification programs. She received both her bachelor's in environmental science and master's in energy and environmental analysis from Boston University in 2008. So with that, I will hand it over to you, Heather.
Thanks, Brian, and thank you to everyone at New Jersey AWRA for inviting me to speak to you today about our HABS mitigation grant project at Spruce Run Reservoir. I keep my camera off for bandwidth preservation purposes here, but I'll turn it on afterwards for questions. All right, so here's an outline of what I'll be covering in this presentation today. While many of the HABS mitigation grants that you've heard about already are for in-lake management efforts, ours is actually in a tributary near the inlet to the reservoir. So I'll cover the history of the Spruce Run HAB and how and the site selection on how we determined to choose the Mohawkaway Creek for our project. And at this time, we don't have final designs nor installation yet, so I'll just provide you with some of the background and plans for what we intend to install and the related monitoring efforts. So the New Jersey Water Supply Authority is a state-created water authority in but not of NJDEP. The authority is tasked with operating and maintaining water supply infrastructure, specifically three reservoirs, Spruce Run, Round Valley, and Manasquan reservoirs, and the 60-mile-long Delaware and Raritan Canal for water supply purposes. In the Raritan system, the authority provides raw water to water purveyors that then treat the water. And the purveyor intake in the Raritan system out of Spruce Run is approximately 24 hours downstream from the reservoir, so it's not right there at the reservoir itself. Between the Raritan Basin and the Manasquan systems, the authority provides water for approximately 2 million Central New Jersey residents. In addition to the operation and maintenance of infrastructure, the authority's watershed protection programs engages in source water protection, planning, and management. The watershed office is situated right on Spruce Run Reservoir, which is was quite a lovely spot until you realize that when you pull in every day and then you just have to peek at the water's edge, and then you might see if that like this lovely picture here that is actually from a year ago, November 2019. It was actually quite late in November, but still the HAB was very, very happy at Spruce Run last year. Spruce Run Reservoir is located in Clinton and Union Townships in Hunterdon County in western New Jersey. Spruce Run is the third largest reservoir in the state and is an 11 billion gallon inline reservoir with two major stream inputs, the Mohawkaway Creek from the west and the Spruce Run Creek from the north. The land surrounding the reservoir is owned by the state of New Jersey and is managed by one of three entities, the New Jersey Water Supply Authority, which manages the infrastructure side of it, the New Jersey State Park Service, which manages the Spruce Run Recreation Area in the middle, and the New Jersey Division of Fish and Wildlife, which manages the Clinton Wildlife Management Area that surrounds most of the western side of the reservoir. At this point, I've highlighted two other features here, specifically the swim beach at the Spruce Run Recreation Area right in the center, and then the outlet tower in the southeast corner of the reservoir. I'll allude to those later in the presentation. At this point, we don't have a lot of in-reservoir characterization data for Spruce Run, but we do know a lot about the contributing watersheds from the Mohawkaway and the Spruce Run. And the Mohawkaway Creek has an NJDEP-approved watershed restoration and protection plan. And the authority has also received a 2020 NJDEP watershed grant to develop a watershed restoration and protection plan for the other three HUB 14 sub-watersheds that drain to the Spruce Run Reservoir, which includes the Spruce Run Creek, the Willoughby Brook, and the Rocky Run, and also the reservoir itself. So we've got two grants going on to HABs for Spruce Run this year. So Spruce Run Reservoir has been increasingly plagued by cyanobacteria blooms, just as the other lakes that you've heard about in recent years, including the fall of 2018, and an extensive bloom from June 2019 through the present. It is still ongoing today. Also, tributaries in both of the major watersheds that drain to Spruce Run Reservoir have also had blooms in recent years, including Manny's Pond on the Mohawkaway Creek watershed in December of 2017 and Crystal Springs Preserve in the Spruce Run watershed in September 2018. Due to the length and scope of the 2019 to 2020 bloom in the reservoir, it's likely that both internal and external nutrient loads are providing a consistent nutrient source for the cyanobacteria. The current and ongoing HAB in Spruce Run was first reported in June of 2019, and the HAB has had many, many visual presentations over the course of the past 18 months and has even been visible in the winter in the pore spaces on the swim beach. Though it's not as widespread and intense as in the summer through fall. The interesting thing that I find at Spruce Run is that the dominant taxa varies quite significantly, even on the same sampling date. We often take samples and submit them to NJDEP from 4 to 5 sites around the reservoir on the same day. And we see a lot of the same usual suspects, the Microcystis, Warnochinia, Dolichospermum, Aphanus aminon, but we've also had Nostoc, Oscillatoria, Lingdia, and Pseudoanabina as the dominant taxa in some of the samples. And I'm sure as you all know that sometimes your sampling doesn't always match up with your worst case day, but we have caught some pretty bad events where we had our highest cell count documented at the reservoir at over 5.5 million cells in 2019. And this year, the highest toxin concentration we had got increased from last year's to 38 micrograms per liter for microcystin. The reservoir remains under watch status at a minimum because the HAB doesn't stay away for very long. So it even when we have not present samples collected, the park side of things usually keeps things at the watch status at a minimum. We have had both the advisory and warning status in 2020 at multiple locations. We have done some additional sampling and have collaborated with USGS to operate a continuous monitoring buoy in Spruce Run since the fall of 2019. We were awarded a USGS Cooperative Matching Funds grant in 2019 to conduct some additional discrete monitoring, including intensive monitoring for algal identification, toxins, toxin genetics, nutrients, and carbon suites at the buoy site. USGS has also deployed SPAT samplers, which you can see in the picture on the right. SPATs are low-cost, passive, time-integrated samplers that are made of a porous synthetic resin. These ones are kind of in embroidery hoops, but we've also been deploying them in little sachets. The SPATs provide continuous toxin measurements to capture ephemeral events that discrete samples can miss, and it's a more robust indicator of toxin prevalence compared to grab samples. With the NJDEP samples and with grab samples at the buoy site, microcystins have been consistently detected at various concentrations throughout the sampling period, but without any other toxins have not been collected in grab samples, either by USGS or DEP, but SPAT results have indicated a presence of anatoxin A during their deployment, and we found gene copies of anatoxin A producing cyanobacteria detected by qPCR in the 2019 samples. Also, discrete samples analyzed by DEP in 2020 also indicated the presence of saxitoxin in Spruce Run. Other nutrient samples that we've collected as a part of a larger study have preliminarily indicated that phosphorus and nitrogen levels are relatively low at Spruce Run, both at the surface and at the bottom, indicating that the external nutrient loads may be more of an issue than the internal load. So you can either say that we're unlucky or lucky that we're one of the water bodies that's monitored by the NJDEP Fixed Wing Aircraft Remote Sensing Program, or flyovers, since 2019. The flyovers have provided us with some interesting information. You might have seen this information, flyovers like this from Lake Hopatcong. I think they've highly publicized those, but they do fly over some other water bodies as well, including Spruce Run. But these flyovers have provided us some interesting information about bloom dynamics and the potential external nutrient loads. So these screenshots I've pulled are just from June and July of 2019. And I've highlighted some key features here. The yellow arrows that you can see are from the inflow from the Mohawkway Creek watershed. The red circles that you see are over the State Park swim beach, and the blue squares are highlighting the outlet tower. This flyover schedule in these pictures here was much more frequent. They're typically done weekly, But this story that we got here when they were flying them pretty frequently at the end of June to mid-July of 2019 gave us some really interesting information. If you recall, in June 2019, there had been several heavy rainfall events that happened every few days. And if you look at the yellow arrows here, you can see that it almost, you can track the bloom coming from the Mohawkaway Creek and pushing it towards the swim beach based on prevailing winds. Blooms often concentrate along the shoreline, which is why you see the red color here, which is estimated to be over 100,000 cells per milliliter based on the DEP's algorithm from their flyovers. We do consistently see higher signatures on the flyovers from the Mohawkaway side of the reservoir, even in 2020 as well, which is one of the reasons that we made the Mohawkaway Creek our focus for this project. The inlet from the Mohawkaway Creek is not easily accessible for any installation to do a project in reservoir here. So that's why we needed to move a little bit upstream where we would have a little bit more accessibility. So since we already had an inclination that the Mohawkaway Creek is likely the one providing significant external nutrient loads, we did some estimates of total phosphorus concentrations at the USGS Mohawkaway Creek Advanced Sickle Monitoring Station. This is a collaborative station between the authority, DEP, and USGS. The USGS has a continuous stream discharge gauge here, and it's 0.3 miles upstream from the inlet of Spruce Run Reservoir, so still really close to the reservoir itself. And the site is also the part of the state's ambient surface water quality monitoring network, which conducts quarterly water quality monitoring for an extensive list of parameters. One of them being total phosphorus, which was where we pulled this information from. The top figure shows the estimated total phosphorus concentrations are higher seasonally in the summer months during this time period. So I just pulled from the last 10 years here. During the later years of this period, you can see that the total phosphorus concentrations have been increasing, likely indicating that this is more of a problem more recently, which is maybe why we've had this continuous bloom for so long. The bottom figure shows the estimated total phosphorus concentrations have decreased during the January and February months at low discharges. And then the estimated total phosphorus concentrations have increased during the late spring, summer, and early fall, and are much more dramatically higher at higher flows. In the absence of any in-reservoir data to support an in-reservoir mitigation technique, we did begin to explore options for in-stream mitigation, which is why the Mohawkaway Creek was our target. So we applied for the DEP HABS mitigation grant, and we were awarded just over $115,000 with in-kind funds of about $63,000 for a total project cost of $178,600. The primary tasks for the HABS mitigation grant include project management, including writing those fund quarterly reports for DEP and final reports, but also include the design and installation of the biochar at the Mohawkaway Creek, and then monitoring to support the project. So what is biochar? Biochar is a highly absorbent burnt plant material, which has an electronegative charge that grabs nutrients. Seems pretty simple, almost seems too good to be true. So we're intrigued by this because it's low cost and it has the high potential for great nutrient removals. We're not aware of any other in-stream applications when we applied for this, applications of biochar. We had heard about it in small ponds and in agricultural places for nutrient removal for algal mitigation, but the nutrient removals alone were at least worth exploring here. So biochar lists impressive metals removals, but also tests from agricultural runoff indicate potentially up to 99% removal rates of phosphorus, which was really intriguing for us here. The demonstration project, if it goes well, has the potential to provide a scalable, low-cost option for in-stream and/or stormwater system applications in order to address nutrient loads that may contribute to HABs in the Spruce Run watershed and other watersheds in New Jersey. So when biochar is loaded into porous bags and then secured in an in-stream application, the natural currents will flow the water through the bag and the biochar. The nutrients are attracted to the biochar, but solids are not attracted. However, they can be filtered because of the jagged exterior of the biochar. There are four different sizes of biochar through their process of when they break it down from the company Biochar Now, which is the one that we're going to be using for our application. The smaller the size, the more surface area you have to attract nutrients. However, that will also mean the slower the flow through the biochar itself. The biochar logs must be replaced on a regular basis, but because this is not like an algicide application, it doesn't require a pesticide applicator's license. So this could be done by someone that's not certified to replace this, which is very attractive for us at the Water Supply Authority. And the nutrient-laden biochar can actually be recovered and then reused in gardens or ag fields for improved plant growth for fertilizer. So we're still in the design phase for the Mohawkaway biochar installation. So these are just some preliminary designs and they have not yet been approved by DEP. The map shows an overhead view of the Mohawkaway Creek installation site and the proposed locations for some of the biochar logs to be placed. Since this site is not an intermittent stream and does have some decent base flow, you can see I just pulled the last 10 years of discharge at the Mohawkaway Creek there and has the potential for pretty significant flashy flow, storm flow here. You can see there's several dates where it's been over 2,000 CFS. The plan is to install biochar logs in several locations and configurations in order to maximize nutrient removals without negatively impacting the stream habitat. Just a note that not all of these sites proposed may be placed, so it may not be covering all of these, but this is just the plan at this point. We do anticipate that the biochar will remain in place all year round, and it'll be about 2 years of installation at this point. We are a little delayed because of COVID and now also because of some other restrictions because of the stream site itself. Our consultant is Princeton Hydro for this, and I think Fred's going to speak after me, so I think he'll have some other nuggets of wisdom about biochar to add in the next presentation as well. So I'm just going to highlight a couple selections of configurations and installations proposed here. In the top picture, you can actually see the bridge, which is Charlestown Road, and you can also see the USGS gauge station there in the top right corner of that picture. The goal is to ensure that the biochar logs, wherever possible, can be below the water level at base flow to provide maximum contact time. And to protect the logs, these pictures here are just showing the logs, but they will be installed in protective cages and secured to the stream because we do have potential high flows here. The half moon design picture in the top uses the vegetation as natural protection here. And then the bottom picture shows logs installed parallel to the shoreline, which can also provide some bank stabilization. The top picture here shows the logs are lining the perimeter of two different pools here by putting them in the pools and keeping them submerged. That also maximizes the contact time. And there's another pool over here. And then the bottom picture here shows a traditional check dam type design, alternating left and right bank in a section that's got uniform width and depth. So while the site is a great location for capturing nutrients before it enters the reservoir, there are some other complications with the site. This site itself is managed by the New Jersey Fish and Wildlife Service, so it's not a portion of the reservoir that is managed by the Water Supply Authority, but we have them on board. The Mohawkaway Creek is a C1 drought production stream, and we're obviously within the regulatory floodway, and that does require some permits, and we do expect to have permits for this. And we are currently working through those, but some of the other things to note is that biochar does hold water in some of the pore spaces. While it does allow water to pass through, it does hold on to some of that water. So we need to make sure that we're not negatively impacting the stream by backing up too much water and causing an issue for the stream bank. And because the water is flowing through and over the bags, we know that we won't see those nutrient removals as high as the 99% that we would see if it was slower moving water or just placed in a pond because we won't have enough contact time. And because we know that we're going to have a lot more water passing through here, we do plan on changing the bags pretty frequently, about every 3 months, to ensure we're getting the highest removal rates as possible because it does decline over time because the pore spaces are filled up by the use. And no demonstration project would be complete without a comprehensive monitoring program. The authority's analysis will focus on identifying upstream versus downstream differences during base flow and storm flow conditions in nutrients. We're going to deploy two ISCO avalanche refrigerated sampler units to capture base flow and stormwater samples upstream and downstream of the biochar installation. The base flow monitoring will occur twice a month during the growing season and once a month during the rest of the year. Base flow conditions for this study are defined as no rainfall for three consecutive days. If a large storm event occurs and the peak takes more time to recede, then the base flow condition will be defined as the daily mean flow has not increased by more than 30% or increased by more than 10% from the previous day. At least three stormwater samples will be collected seasonally each season with the goal of collecting small, intermediate, and large scale rain events. And the stormwater samples will be considered viable if they're collected at least 3 days after any previous storm of 0.1 inch or more of rainfall. We are going to be doing, so with the units, we're going to be collecting for total phosphorus, TKN, nitrate, nitrite, TSS, and turbidity. And we also have a YSI Pro DSS to do the discrete in situ parameters of temp, DO, SC, pH, chlorophyll A, and phycocyanin. Our quality assurance plan has already been through one round of reviews by DEP so far. So hopefully we'll have that finalized very soon. And I just want to mention this related research project because it relates to several of the DEP HAB mitigation and watershed management grants. We received a nationally competitive grant in cooperation with the USGS New Jersey Water Science Center, Montclair State University, and NJDEP, where we are studying the downstream fate and transport of cyanobacteria and cyanotoxins in the Raritan Basin. This project combines continuous real-time phycocyanin and chlorophyll sensor monitoring, grab sampling for phytoplankton community nutrients and microcystins, and SPAT sampling for microcystins. There are three water bodies in the Raritan Basin upstream of the water purveyor intakes, which includes Spruce Run, Bud Lake, and Rosedale Lake that have had confirmed HABs over the past 2 years. And all three of these received HAB mitigation grants. You already heard about the Rosedale Lake project. And both Bud Lake and Spruce Run have also received watershed management grants. So there's a lot of DEP-funded HAB mitigation going on in these watersheds. So this was a project that we thought was really interesting. And so the sampling for the downstream fate and transport project began in August of this year and will continue through July of 2021. And we expect to have the final results and analysis in 2022. And I just want to give some information about this in case anyone is interested, and you can feel free to reach out to me afterwards on this. So this just provides some details about the sampling for that project and the parameters. And if you're interested, there are now continuous monitors for phycocyanin and chlorophyll that are operational and have data available on the public-facing USGS website for monitors installed at the outflow of Bud Lake, South Branch at Highbridge, Spruce Run at Clinton, Raritan River at Manville, Stony Brook at Princeton, which is downstream of Rosedale Lake, and the Millstone River at Blackwell's Mills. And if anyone has any questions, I will turn on my camera now.
Thanks so much, Heather. So if anyone has any questions, feel free to post them in the chat here. I have one or two questions here. You mentioned permitting here, so I'm assuming you're referring to maybe flood hazard permitting for these type of installations?
Yes, I think we have freshwater wetlands and flood hazard areas. General permits is what we expect at this time.
Okay. I was wondering if you've had any discussions kind of leading up to the design here about how DEP views these, you know, if they're looking at them as stream obstructions and fill in the floodway, and if that is something that you see as being a potential issue or not.
We've had some preliminary discussions with DEP, but we have not had our permit coordination meetings yet, but they gave us the money for the project, and they had obviously discussed right. The land use. So I think that they, you know, we're looking to work with them to make sure that we're doing it the right way that they're willing to work with us on. So, and I, you know, my consultants are on here if they want to jump in and if they've got other thoughts on that. Not to call you out, JP.
This is Fred. I can chime in real quickly. Yeah, due to the high quality and sensitivity of the site, we figured that we would have to go through a permit process. I do know for a PACON, for a number of our projects, we put in for a blanket permit for authorization, since we were doing a variety of things, installation of aeration equipment and the biochar. And then for anything that involved any sort of treatment of water, we got a, you know, for anything that was identified as a pesticide, we had to get an, obviously, you know, the pesticide application. But then even with that, we had to apply for a NPDES for the Phosloc. So there were some permitting involved, but like Heather mentioned, DEP provided the grants and we're walking through with them. So they know what the project is and they're working with us to make sure everything goes off as planned, but making sure we're working within the existing permit process.
Okay, thanks.
Thanks, Fred.
No problem.
And one follow-up question here. By the way, Dana Patterson provided some feedback there also, noting that it would require permits given the Mohawkaway Creek is a regulated water. But another question here is that I had, you know, is there any concerns about if the bags were to break and the material was to come out of the bags? Is that something that's a big concern, or would that be relatively, you know, no adverse effects if that were to happen?
I think it would be relatively innocuous, you know, if that were to happen. You know, these are things that can be used, and it to my understanding, the biochar holds on to the nutrients and it doesn't then release them later on. So it would just it's burnt plant material. So it's, you know, if you were to burn some wood in your yard and that got in the stream, that wouldn't provide too much of an issue. But it is something that we're going to keep an eye on. Obviously monitoring those very frequently after storm flows to make sure that we don't have any issues there.
Yeah, and just to let you know, again, this is Fred. I can chime in on that from experience that I'll be talking about in a few minutes. But so we did install some at Lake Apacon in a set of streams. And there were times where we went back after an extremely heavy stream, we would find the biochar bags weren't broken, but they were misplaced. They were moved to the side or up on the bank. So we've had situations with pretty strong storms move the biochar, which is why, again, we're looking now at cages and more and stronger structures, but we haven't had them break. That has not happened, at least over the course of the 2020 growing season.
Okay, thanks.
Yep.
All right, well, thanks a lot, Heather, for that presentation. It was great.
Thank you.
All right, Fred, I'm gonna make you the presenter here. All right, so Fred, Lubnow will be giving the final presentation here on Lake Hopatcong and the work there. And Fred is the director of the aquatic program at Princeton Hydro and the office manager of the Exton, Pennsylvania office. He received a bachelor's degree from Susquehanna, master's in environmental science, and a PhD in limnology from the University of California, Davis. He has been an environmental consultant for over 26 years and has worked on a variety of ecosystems throughout the mid-Atlantic states. And so with that, I'll hand it over to you, Fred.
Right, thank you. So everyone can see that fine?
Yes, we can see it.
All right, excellent. Okay, thank you. So I'm just gonna jump right into it for the objectives of this talk. I'll give a little bit of background on the unique properties of cyanobacteria, although everyone's touched on it in their earlier presentations. I'll briefly talk about what triggered the regional blooms that started in June of 2019 throughout the mid-Atlantic states. I'll be talking about the PACON HAB grant, and I'll provide some preliminary data on some of the projects that we've implemented. So this is just showing you some photomicrographs of some common cyanobacteria. There's a Delictus spermum over on the right, and keep an eye on that clear cell in the upper right. That's called a heterocyst. I'll talk about that in just a second. The cyanobacteria in the upper left is Anthanizomenon. That will look like grass clippings in the water. And then the one in the lower left is Microcystis. So cyanobacteria are pretty interesting types of bacteria that they're, and it's been said before that they're basically bacteria that pretend to be algae or plants. They can photosynthesize in a wide variety of light intensities. So they can photosynthesize right at the surface while they make those surface scums, or they can go down pretty deep and still gather light for energy. They have these heavy spores called aconites. So as the temperature declines and they start to die off, these heavy spores sink to the bottom. And then in the spring, when a lake or pond mixes, those aconites go back up to the surface and they hatch and you have more cyanobacteria. That clear cell I showed is called a heterocyst, and that's a site where they can fix nitrogen, gaseous nitrogen. So some of the cyanobacteria can actually fix their own nitrogen, which means they're not dependent on nitrogen in the water. So that makes them not dependent on how much nitrogen is in the water, at least for the freshwater, these freshwater types. Now, to fix your own nitrogen, you need a lot of phosphorus. And this is why, as phosphorus concentrations increase, not only do we see more algae, we see more of the bad algae, the cyanobacteria. And they have some enzymes that allow them to cleave phosphorus off of organic compounds. So they're very crafty at trying to get phosphorus wherever they can. They can regulate their position in the water column through gas vacuoles. And again, that was discussed previously with the ultrasonic. So they can move up and down the water column. That's why they make those scums at the surface. They can outcompete the other algae for light. Then they can collapse those gas vacuoles and sink to the deeper waters to fuel up on nutrients. And that's why that ultrasonic, I asked the question is if they're breaking that gas vacuole, the ability to make those, that's how they sink to the bottom and die. And then finally, they can make these large colonies and generate cyanotoxins, which make them not very pleasant to taste with zooplankton and other microorganisms that could potentially graze on them. So the conditions that you really need to generate a cyanobacterial algal bloom is really three. And I think all the speakers have touched on these, that you need seasonally high temperatures, still water conditions, and they like still water conditions so they can move up and down the water column with those gas vacuoles. And then they need higher phosphorus concentrations. So generally, if your concentrations are at 0.03 milligrams per liter or greater, you have the chance of suffering through a cyanobacterial bloom. So temperature, this is just something that I just put up there to show, you know, the how climate change has been impacting the average annual temperature in the Northeast of the United States. But to bring it closer to home, here is our 30-year database of Lake Apacon. This is, all I did here was we took the surface temperature in July. So we've been consistently monitoring Lake Apacon since the early 90s, taking the July temperature from Station 2, which is a mid-lake station away from any sort of shading from trees or buildings. And basically, we have this statistically significant increase in temperature over the last 30 years at Lake Apacon. Heather touched on this, that in June of 2019, we got into this cycle of we'd have these intense storms followed by a few days of sunny weather. So we have these high temperature conditions coupled with these intense storms, sunny weather, intense storms, sunny weather. And that's really what set up a lot of the lakes, not only in New Jersey, but throughout the Mid-Atlantic, in New York, in Maryland, Delaware, in Pennsylvania. We resulted in having these blooms. And it was already mentioned, the economic and recreational impacts, in addition to the water quality and ecological impacts of these blooms. And such blooms such as these have been seen at Lake Apacon in the past. It's just typically they would happen in the late summer or fall. So this bloom, like in a lot of lakes in 2019, it hit in June and it just stayed there. And it's really because of this alternating weather pattern we had that was established in June. For just a little information on Lake Apacon, so it's the largest lake in New Jersey. It straddles Sussex and Morris County. There are five municipalities within the watershed, but four have lakefront property. and more than half a million people visit the lake or live within the watershed. This is a map just showing our standard long-term monitoring stations. So we do establish other temporary sampling sites. For example, we've added additional sampling locations as part of the HAB grants. But these stations here represent our long-term monitoring that we've been doing consistently since the early 90s. And like I mentioned, blooms aren't a rarity at Lake Opatcon. It's just in the past, they would hit in the late summer or even in the fall. And once the blooms would hit after, say, Labor Day, the impact on the economy or the perception from people wasn't as dramatic as it was in 2019 because it hit at the beginning of the summer season. We did have blooms this year at Lake Opatcon. Here's one that it was in Mount Arlington in August of 2020, but the blooms weren't covering the entire lake, number one. And number two, they hit later in the summer. So blooms do continue, and it's something that everyone is very concerned about at Lake Opatcon, but it was just 2019 was such a devastating year. And ironically, what it did was if those blooms did anything, it really helped to get everyone on board with, hey, we need to address this on a short and long-term basis. This is a bloom earlier this week. And this is something that is an impact of climate change that 10, 15 years ago, usually once we hit September going into early October, things would quiet down relative to halves, that the water would turn brown because you would have blooms of diatoms or chrysophytes, and these blooms just wouldn't occur again until the spring. Well, now we're seeing these blooms linger on well into, you know, October, November, even going over the winter, like Heather mentioned. And, you know, for recreational water bodies, that might not be as such a concern, but for drinking water supplies, that's something that is very problematic. This is just showing you the long-term average June total phosphorus concentration at Lake Opatcon. And the one thing I want to point out is if you look all the way to the right, the data point from 2019, it was the first time in over 20 years that the phosphorus concentration in June exceeded 0.04. That, again, is what helped to trigger those massive blooms. So it was a combination of the weather, the higher temperatures, and these higher phosphorus concentrations that triggered these wide-scale blooms at Lake Opatcon, which resulted in some big impacts throughout that summer season. So the Lake Opatcon HAB grant, so it was the 2020 grant made available through DEP. The Lake Opatcon Commission submitted the application. They received $500,000. There is a match of about $300,000, which is a combination of both money and in-kind service. So both the commission and foundation provides both in-kind and financial support. In addition to that, Sussex and Morris counties each contributed $25,000 toward the grant. And then the four municipalities, the Township of Jefferson, the Borough of Opatcon, the Borough of Mount Arlington, and the Township of Roxbury, all are contributing large amounts of in-kind service, and they've been very good, very great working with. Rutgers University is involved in a training program that I'll touch on, but they also provided some in-kind match. We're the technical and environmental engineering consultant, Princeton Hydro, and I do want to say thank you to our staff. Our staff, you know, even in view of COVID, they were out doing the monitoring, doing the installations, doing the treatments, you know, starting from March all the way up to, you know, they're still out there now. So I really have to tip my hat to all of our field staff. And then on a side note, I do want to say a year before the HABs hit, in 2018, the New Jersey Highlands Council provided funding to the commission to update their restoration plan to a watershed implementation plan. And the final version of that plan was just submitted. So it just so happened that we have a plan, an implementation plan, to continue on the efforts to address phosphorus within Lake Opatcon. It's linked to the lake's TMDL, and we're trying to get the average total phosphorus concentration throughout the lake to be
average of 0.03 milligrams per liter. Through the last 12 years, 15 years, we've implemented a wide variety of projects, and we've reduced our load by about 33%, you know, to comply with the TMDL. So we have 66% to go, and that's what that watershed implementation plan is doing. It updated the plan, provided additional projects and technology. So I just want to thank the New Jersey Highlands Council providing that funding to the commission so that they could update that plan. So this is a list of the projects that we've implemented. Some we've implemented, some we're in progress of implementing, and some will not be implemented until next year. So we did a large application of a product called Foslock to reduce algae growth. That project was completed. We've done an alternative to copper-based algicides, a product called Green Clean, which is a strong oxidizing product. That was completed, and I'll be going in more detail in each of these after this slide. We've used biochar in select areas throughout the watershed. We have a program specifically for Ashley Cove, which is a 2-acre cove that's sort of separated from the lake that the weed harvesters, when they're deployed over the summer, they'll temporarily store them in Ashley Cove up in the northern end of the lake in Jefferson. There we're using a combination of Foslock, biochar, and next year we'll be installing some floating wetland islands in there. We have some innovative nearshore aeration technologies. We're also installing biochar in some large existing stormwater structures called aquafilters. And then finally, Rutgers has a rain garden program that's currently in progress for the watershed. So I'm going to go through some of these projects. Foslock is a clay-based product that inactivates a phosphorus very similar to alum, but it does not use aluminum. Instead, it uses lanthanum as the active product to inactivate the phosphorus. It can be used to strip the water column of phosphorus, or it can be used in deep water phosphorus. And it was mentioned several times how you can have internal loading if you have a deep lake and it goes anoxic. A lot of the when the deep water oxygen is depleted, there's a chemical reaction where phosphorus and iron, that bond is broken, and the phosphorus begins to leak up into the overlying water. Remember, the blue-greens can move up and down the water column, so they can go down pretty deep and fuel up on that phosphorus. If you apply this product over those deep water sediments, you can inactivate a lot of that phosphorus. But in this case, we were using the Foslock to inactivate phosphorus that comes over shallower sediments, where there's more biological activity that can be releasing phosphorus. So the Foslock, the advantage to it is that it can, it does not have aluminum in it, and it also can inactivate organic and inorganic phosphorus, where alum only inactivates inorganic phosphorus. The disadvantage to the Foslock is it's more expensive than alum. So, and I always say this, every technology or management technique, Everyone has its advantages, its limitations, and its costs. So you always have to keep that in mind. So we did a treatment area. This is in the southern end of Lake Apacon. It's called Landing Channel. It's down in the township of Roxbury. It's in the southern end of Lake Apacon. We did about a 50-acre area. The Foslock was applied between the 15th and the 17th of June. We applied 22,000 pounds of product. It's one of the largest treatments of Foslock that has occurred in the United States. We've used this product in other lakes and ponds, but we tend to use it in smaller areas or we use it in smaller ponds. This was a pretty large application, and we added about 440 pounds per acre over the treatment area. And just to put this within context, I just want to show you the water quality goals we're trying to achieve. So we're trying to keep the TP concentrations at the surface, whether it's a mean or a specific value, we want them to be at least 0.03 milligrams per liter or less. We're trying to keep average chlorophyll A concentrations at 8 micrograms per liter. We're trying to keep the targeted maximum. So the maximum bloom we would like to see is something around 14 micrograms per liter. And we're looking for a secchi depth. And a secchi disc is an alternating black and white disc you lower into the water. We want that degree of clarity to be at least a meter or 3.3 feet. When it's less than a meter, that's when people say water looks a little scummy, it looks a little dirty, I wouldn't want to swim in there. So those are our water quality goals, and they're directly linked to the lake's TMDL as well as the watershed implementation plan. And again, a lot of this data is very preliminary. Our staff just literally finished about a week or so collecting some of the stormwater data, and we've been crunching through. So the first thing I want to show is, if you look at the graph on the left, this is the deep water phosphorus. So this is immediately over the sediments. Now, landing channel is not very deep. It's maybe 6 to 10 feet deep, but we did the treatment. And the biggest thing I want to show is, if you look at that blue line, that's SRP, that's soluble reactive phosphorus. Total phosphorus is the gray bar. Total phosphorus is like food for algae, but the soluble reactive phosphorus is like candy. That's the stuff that they're going to eat first. And if you look on that first treatment, that first sampling event, which was the 12th of June, over to the left, that was done before the treatment. So the three events after were done after the treatment was completed. So what we did see was SRP concentrations immediately over the sediments declined. So they went from something being like 0.02 down to 0.01, and consistently below 0.01, which is really important. You want to keep that as low as possible. We did see in July, you see that big spike we had in total phosphorus, that gray bar. That was linked actually to a rain event. It was actually a rainy day when we went out. So more than likely, you can see it also on the figure on the right, which is the surface water concentrations. We also saw an elevation of phosphorus. I can also tell you that at our long-term monitoring stations, they all had higher phosphorus concentrations that day due to a rain event. So more than likely, that's what was attributing those elevated concentrations. We do see, though, when we went from July to September, SRP over the sediments stayed low, but we did have an increase in SRP from the July event to September. But when we look at how the algae responded to the phosphorus, so we had a substantial reduction in the cyanobacteria 12 days after the treatment. We had an increase in clarity to the bottom. In addition to that, we did see a decrease in, we saw a slight decrease. Anyway, I'm trying to look over here. Let me just move this. So we did see a slight decrease in the phycocyanin. And again, that phycocyanin is a pigment that only blue-green algae produce, where chlorophyll A is something all algae, whether it's a cyanobacteria or some other algae group, produce. So it's interesting, when we went from before the treatment to after the treatment in June, we saw an increase in chlorophyll, but a decrease in the phycocyanin. And the reason for that is the good algae, the green algae, the diatoms, the ones you want, increased, but the bad algae declined, so they decreased. But then we did see an increase in both phycocyanin and chlorophyll A and the cyanobacteria cell counts in July. Now, one thing I can say is that when you do look at the chlorophyll A concentrations, that they were below the maximum concentration until we got to July. Once we got to July, they were slightly above that measurement that we want of that 14 micrograms per liter. But we then saw a decline in the cell counts and in the phycocyanin and chlorophyll A once we hit September, which ironically was when, in a lot of areas throughout the lake, we actually saw an increase in cyanobacteria throughout the lake. Because like I mentioned, at Lake Apacon, a lot of times our heaviest blooms occur in the late summer, early fall season. And we did see that secchi depth remained at a meter or better in the landing channel area. So again, we have more data to crunch. We collected data on microcystins, but I can tell you microcystins were not detected either before or after the treatment. Right? So the next thing that we did was we did a green clean treatment, which green clean is a strong oxidizer, does not have copper. So again, that's the advantage to green clean, is you're not putting a heavy metal into the water. You're not putting copper into the water. Disadvantages is you have green clean is you have to be careful handling the product, number one. And number two, it's more expensive. And I do want to emphasize that anything that's a pesticide, you do need to have a licensed applicator conduct the treatment, and that applicator needs to file for a permit. So here we did the treatment along Cap Beach in the township of Jefferson. The treatment was conducted on the 13th over a two acre area. And this is showing you the area here. And when we look at the data, what's interesting is we saw, we collected data the day before the treatment and then about 5 or 6 days after the treatment. We saw an increase in clarity. So it went from 0.8 to 1 meter. But we did see an increase in both chlorophyll and phycocyanin and cell counts. So it's interesting that we did see an increase in clarity, but chlorophyll and phycocyanin increase. So what I have to do is, you know, we'll have to look at the different types of cyanobacteria and algae to see if that increase was attributed to maybe smaller algae that would allow for better clarity. The other thing to keep in mind is look where this beach is located. It's in open waters. It's not like it's in an isolated cove. So any treatment would have a limited duration of improvement, but it did increase the clarity at that beach. So again, we have to tease that data a little further to see what happened there. As Heather mentioned, we've been using biochar. So we've been doing it in three different ways. So I'm not gonna dwell too much on it because Heather did a great job introducing you to the product. I will say that we did a feasibility assessment throughout the watershed. We selected 4 stream sites, 2 stormwater ponds, and 2 manufactured treatment devices for stormwater where we were installing the biochar. In addition to that, we had a pretty good, we actually had an excellent training session with all 4 municipalities around the watershed. So the municipalities, the whole idea is to have the municipalities eventually be responsible for these activities. So the municipalities really like this product for 2 reasons. Number one, it's not that expensive. And number two is, what do I do with it when I'm done with it? And as Heather mentioned, this can be used as some sort of mulch or some sort of soil or garden amendment. So that made it very attractive. And so the municipalities were, the public works department staffs were very positive about these projects. And so we had a training session with them at the Lake Capacon Foundation's headquarters, showed them how to do it. They provided a lot of assistance and support. And eventually the idea is to have them be responsible for the maintenance in these. And again, it's relatively low in cost. So this is just showing you some of the locations. In the lower right, that's Katie and Ivy out in the field installing some of those in one of the stream sites. In the upper left is one of the stormwater ponds that feeds into Lake Capacon where we installed the biochar. And over to the right is one of the manufactured treatment devices where we're going, where we actually laid the biochar in there. And I just want to show you some data. So we actually have some information here. So for the streams, they were installed the 2nd of July. After 8 days, we had TP removal rates that varied from 0 to 55%. And after 8 days for SRP, we had removal rates from 2 to 58%. And again, this is during a storm event. This was stormwater sampling. Those removal rates, are, especially when you're looking at the 55 and 58, those are pretty good, particularly for the SRP. The manufactured treatment devices that are installed, you're typically only getting between 30 to 40% removal of just total phosphorus because it functions by settling out the particles. So if we add the biochar to the stormwater structures, we're hoping we're going to get a higher level of removal rates. And so we still have to sample the stormwater structures. We've just completed the stream stuff. But what we did see at the streams is after 3.5 months, the removal rates for both the SRP and the TP were pretty low. And like Heather mentioned, this looks like we're going to have to replace these, 3 months or even less. So we are gonna do some supplemental sampling next year to see if we can get to the 3 month mark and try to stay within the 55 to 58%. The other thing too is we have to tease apart the data. Why were we getting some pretty good removal rates at some sites, but we weren't getting some good removal sites at others? So we have to really parse through the data and look at these sites. So that's the stream data. pond data, though, was a lot better. And this isn't surprising because, as Heather mentioned, and as the manufacturer mentioned, the longer the contact time, the higher the removal rate. So we also heard that for phosphorus, you can easily get 90%+ removal. And what we saw is after 3 months in the ponds, so where we installed the biochar in the stormwater ponds was near the outlet, so we can sample in the pond and then immediately below the outlet. As the water is moving through the biochar. So total phosphorus we were getting removal rates for the two ponds were 67% and 81%. And then 3 months for the SRP, we were getting 76% and 97%. And that is great. That is really good. And the manufacturer did state that the longer the contact time, the better the removal rate. So we are experimenting with the particle sizes. And again, Heather had that great illustration showing the different sizes. The project manager, JP, we actually tried, now we haven't done the stormwater sampling yet for the stormwater structures, but we have experimented with the particle sizes. So JP did a mix of particles to try to increase the contact time. But it turns out in one of the stormwater structures, we were starting to get a little backup, a little bit of flooding of the water. So after we heard that, we decided not to do that anymore. So we're going with the larger particle sizes in the stormwater structure. So we still have to do the stormwater sampling for that yet. So we're working on some additional redesigns and installations. And for a pack plant, I think we're going to try maybe installing it right where a stream or a gully enters the lake. So maybe getting the contact time once the water is actually in Lake Hopatcon. And this is just showing you, this is Ashley Cove. So again, this is a cove that's showing before and after the biochar. So we did install biochar here, but to be perfectly honest, in addition to the biochar at Ashley Cove, we also have been doing a series of these low dose phosphate treatments as well as one green clean treatment. So we did do that in Ashley Cove. That's why it did look better. I wanted to show those before and afters, but I wanted to emphasize it wasn't just the biochar. So we started with Ashley Cove and we were just going to use Phosloc just to keep the phosphorus under control. We saw some algae buildup, so we replaced one of the Phosloc treatments with a green clean treatment. We did that treatment and went back to Phosloc. And you can see that, you know, we've had some, not surprising, we had some low concentrations at the beginning of the growing season. They increased and then they declined by October. But the thing that we're really happy about is we managed to keep the phosphorus concentrations in Ashley Cove. We didn't keep them below 0.03, but we kept them at or below 0.4. And historically, Ashley Cove has had very high phosphorus concentrations. So we did some pretty detailed sampling in 2012, and that average was 0.07. So we have seen a decline in the amount of phosphorus in the water. And even though in the early September, we saw an increase in the phycocyanin, the chlorophyll A, and the cyano cell counts, they quickly subsided. And it was amazing that in October, that sample, the algae in the October sample had no blue-green algae. We had only the good algae. That's why we could measure chlorophyll in that sample, where other sections throughout the lake were suffering through some of those HABs. So we're going to continue with the Ashley Cove project. Like I mentioned, we'll be installing some floating wetland islands in there as well. So I'm going to try to wrap this up. We're also in the process of installing three innovative nearshore aeration systems. The first one is in Shore Hills. It's an air curtain, an air bubbler, which basically agitates the water, makes it more difficult for those HABs to accumulate and make problems, particularly along beach areas. That project was just completed last week. This is a nanobubble system with ozone. So nanobubbles are extremely small air bubbles. They're supposed to be far more efficient at keeping the water agitated and breaking down organic matter, but we're also adding an ozone system to this to help break down that organic matter and algae. That was, that's I think still under installation. And then we'll also be installing another system in the spring. So next spring we'll be evaluating those three systems. The remaining projects we have, we're working on cleaning out two large existing stormwater structures and replacing them with biochar so we can do some monitoring. Rutgers is doing a very well-received rain garden program, educational and outreach. They completed one in the fall. They have another one coming up in the winter and spring, and that's been very well received. And we're basically moving forward to evaluate the effectiveness of these nearshore treatments. So just to wrap up real quickly, high temperature, still water conditions, elevated phosphorus concentrations, that's what triggers these haves. Lake Hopatcong Commission and all the stakeholders have really been implementing a wide variety of technologies to evaluate how to control these haves. We'll be providing final report and assessments next year. The last thing I do want to say, and this is a plug for anyone who is looking at long-term monitoring for haves, DEP has mentioned a number of times that they're looking at setting up relationships between phycocyanin and cyanobacteria cell counts. This year, we invested in these fluoroprobes that, you know, they're handheld, they're not hard to use. You can get a direct measurement of phycocyanin. And at Lake Hopatcong, what we did is every time we took a measurement of phycocyanin, we also grabbed a sample to do an analysis of cyanobacteria cell counts. We found a statistically significant relationship, very strong relationship of 0.82 of an R squared if you're a stat nerd like myself. But basically what this says is we can now say just by measuring phycocyanin what that cell count should be. And that's something that will be really important in the future because that's where DEP sees this moving forward. So you're not waiting for a lab to process a cell count result, that you can have real-time data just by dunking a meter into the water. So thank you for indulging me on that. I appreciate it.
Thanks so much, Fred. Anyone has questions, you can post it in the chat. Dana threw a link up there on the chat if you want to check it out of a video of the actual Phosloc treatment at Lake Hopatcong. One quick question I had was just the, obviously when you apply the Phosloc, it settles down to the sediment. There's got to be some long-term benefits of that. What's your typical frequency of treatments, you know, these major ones that you do as well as the more low dose versions of the treatments?
Yeah, that's why we're doing the evaluation. You know, we'll be continuing to monitor. If this was a deep water treatment, you know, typically those deep water treatments are good for, and a lot of it depends on the flushing rate of the water body, but a deep water treatment is typically good for 5 to 10 years. This is a shallow water area, so we don't know how long it's going to last. So that's why, you know, with the commission, we'll continue to closely monitor those deep water concentrations. It might be 2 to 5 years for that. And again, that was a heavy dose rate. Very different than the treatments we were doing at Ashley Cove, which were basically very light treatments just to strip the phosphorus out of the water column. And that's why we saw a reduction in the phosphorus there, that we went from 0.07 to 0.04. So two very different techniques. One's more of just temporarily stripping the phosphorus out, maybe buying some time over a growing season. The other, we're hoping to get maybe 2 to 5 years of control.
Okay, thanks.
Yep.
Well, thanks to all the presenters today. Very interesting presentations. It'll be great to hopefully maybe get this group back together again, maybe a year from now after everyone has a lot more data on the implementation projects that they're working on. For the folks attending here, keep a lookout for an email that we'll be sending out soliciting feedback on the presentations from today, as well as directions on if you're interested in getting a certificate of attendance here. So again, thanks everyone, and thank you to all the presenters.
Thanks a lot, everyone.